to go. Okay, I'm going to give you this.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I guess I'm. So good evening or good afternoon. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Nicholas Negroponte. I'm one of the co-founders of the Media Lab, and I'm not going to really be the MC, but you're going to see me come and go, and if people take too long, I might be pushed out to grab them off the stage. I was not only a colleague of Muriel's, I think it's fair to say she was my best friend. I've known her since the early 1960s, and she had an enormous influence on me. And even though she was roughly 20 years older than I, we did things as almost like brother and sister. We traveled together, we worked together. I was in the architecture department at one end of the building on Massachusetts Avenue, and she was on the other end. And we really spent so much time together. I would say, on average, dinner twice a week. It's not obvious, that's average. And partly that was because her house and MIT, if you drew a straight line, I was in the middle of it. So she would pick me up with this Chevrolet Impala that was infested with dog hairs. I would get into garbage bags, because I wore a suit and a tie in those days, and I would get into the car with my garbage bags. We'd come to, she'd drop me off at Building 7, and she'd go to the MIT press. And then when the Media Lab got created, the Visible Language Workshop, which you'll hear a lot about, became very much part of the initial groups that sort of formed the Media Lab, and Muriel worked here as one of our most colorful and important faculty members. Now, there are two Muriels. There's a Muriel that we know from her work, and there are quite a few people in the room who didn't know her as a person. Because you may be too young, or you just didn't have the chance to know Muriel. And the Muriel that we see in her work is crisp, it's incisive, it's almost Cartesian, it's maybe even Helvetica, if you could use the word generally, to describe something rather Swiss and precise. And the Muriel, the second Muriel, the persona, I guess the first word would be much more colorful, much less decisive. For those of you who remember going out for dinner with Muriel and how she ordered food at a restaurant, it drove waiters crazy. She'd say, can you make this without, I'd prefer that if it doesn't, the succotash without the corn and so on. And it wasn't crisp. And so the two Muriels created an influence that just never left this laboratory. And I'm sure many people who didn't know the persona will by the end of today, because a lot of the speakers knew Muriel very well. A lot of the participants also did, so the coffee break, everybody will have Muriel Cooper stories. And I'm not going to bore you with too many of these, but in the early days of the Media Lab, we had a lot of funding from the military. And there was a general who was in charge of what I think was then called the 7th Army, which was all the army in Europe, and who came to the Media Lab and met Muriel. And when he meets Muriel, he says, "How much do you know about theaters?" And she said, "I know a lot. I studied to be an actress." And he said, "That's not that kind of theater." And he then sort of, he says to, because these guys don't come alone, there's privates, they're people, and he says, "Where's the men's room?" And a private says, "A hand grenade's throw down the corridor, sir." Muriel used that expression for the next 10 years. She would tell people, "Oh, you need the men's room? It's a hand grenade's throw down the corridor." So that's the kind of person Muriel was. When Jerry Wiesner and I were raising money, this was before either building was built, he brought Avery Fisher around, and he says, "Let's go introduce Avery Fisher to Muriel." And he introduces Muriel, says, "Muriel, this is Avery Fisher." And Muriel says, "Oh, are you the fat cat?" And Jerry wanted to die. He never forgave her. He quoted the story over and over again, but he always did it with a lot of laughs. So I think today you'll hear, if you don't hear explicit stories, you're going to hear about a person who really made the Media Lab different. We pride ourselves in being different, but boy, Muriel was very, very different. So in keeping with that, when we did this event, or when we were starting to think of this event, it's almost the case that the people who aren't here are dead. That was the only excuse. Almost everybody else came. And really, it's almost 100% showing in terms of the who was invited and who actually got here. And then when we asked people to help with the graphics and people to help do the event, we go to our usual port of call, the gold standard of graphics, we went to Pentagram. Now, we go to Pentagram for everything, so going to Pentagram wasn't that special. But Pentagram, thanks to Aaron, thanks to Aaron Fay, Michael Beirut, and I don't know if I know, have I met Daisy Lee? Are you here?
No, she's the one that does all the work.
She does all the work. Well, she's not even here, but you guys, you know, you hit it out of the box, and I know exactly why. And we're going to see this again over the afternoon. So I don't have to introduce the next speaker. Muriel will, in a video that I believe will roll in a second. Thank you.
Muriel was with MIT Press for quite a while. She's been with the Media Lab for quite a while. She's always been two or three steps ahead of me with everything she did. And it's an honor and a pleasure to have Muriel join us today. Thank you, Muriel.
Thank you. I have a confession, and I hope that everybody in the audience will forgive me. In those early days when we were both very young and terrified, I made the mistake. I remember how I did it, I remember when I did it, and I think I remember where I did it, but I'm damned if I know why I did it. I introduced Nikki to Ricky.
Can you turn, I know you're filming this or doing something, but turn the lights down so I can see the audience, please. Please just turn them down. Somebody has a switch for the lights, and I know you don't want to do it, but it'll be fine. Just turn them down, please, so I can see the audience. Those lights that are in my face, that's just better. Oh, yes. I have to do that every time you give a speech. You can't see the audience. And if you can't see a face, how can you give a chat? Well, my opening lines were not Nikki to Ricky, but I was going to say that Nicholas... I was introduced to Nicholas by Muriel. She changed my life. Lives have moments. Lives are not continuums. You might look back and think they're continuums. No, they're just moments, and you forget a lot of the shit between the moments. But the moments, they really change you. And it's not that you should forget that there's stuff between it, but it really is just stuff. A lot of stuff. Like George Carlin used to talk about stuff. Anyway, she introduced me to Nicholas in the when he had the architecture machine. That was a change in my life. And her wanting to introduce me to somebody else who she felt was very important was a change in my life. Recently, people have been telling me that I'm abrasively charming. There's a certain truth in both those things, that I am abrasive and I am charming. I know you're not supposed to say either about yourself, but it's perfectly clear what I'm saying. And if you're clear, that beats every other thing. Just being clear is enough. And so I could never get any I wouldn't have gotten the media, the MIT Press or anybody else to publish any of my little books. And I have been doing books for a while. I just have an idea and I do a little book and I don't have a publisher. I spit it out. But she indulged me and got them to do exceptions about a whole bunch of little booklets that I did over the years. And she really changed my life. I did something for her, but I didn't know I was doing it, and she didn't know I was doing it. But in the last year of her life, I finally got to her, and she's everything that Nicholas said. The dogs, the car, her taking off her shoes, walking around in her socks. I mean, but she didn't know she was doing it. It was just what she was. If I used to dress funny when I went to Penn, but I knew purposely I was trying to get attention. She wasn't trying to get attention. She was just being herself, just about as genuine as she could be. I mean, that was just her. I was always more phony than she was. I came and saw her stuff here a number of times. By the way, I said it to Juan Enriquez as I came in. We had a quick conversation. And for some reason, I had never said that before, but I realized that it's something I should repeat. This is, the greatest real school in the world. There's some woo-woo schools that are probably nice, that little kids count beads and they do things and they think they learn to be nice people and all those things. There's a lot of little woo-woo schools at different things and experimental schools. But this school is extraordinary. What Nicholas has done, the others following Nicholas, paralleling Nicholas, the effect he's had on the world. I walked around, I was early because I had nothing to do. And I walked around the school and my goodness, it really is Disneyland for grown-ups. It's a dream. It's the waking dream. And so this is a great place that we're all sitting in here. And great places attract great people. And Muriel was a great person. She was just simply a great person. And I finally convinced her I started a conference I ran for a while called TED. And I finally convinced her to come to one of the fifth TED conference. And she came with David Small, who's in the audience here. And they came and I had her scheduled, I think, for the second day. I don't remember when you were scheduled, David, but I think it was the second day. It might have been the first. And she came with David and they had nothing. They had nothing to show. They hadn't worked on it. She just came in. And I was just depressed about that. And so I changed I could do what I wanted. I changed the program and I think they were on the fourth day. And then they stayed up for 3 days. And they developed their presentation. It was a charrette beyond charrettes. It was amazing. I told David if I say something that at least makes the story understandable, not to stand up. If I say something that really disturbs him and is not factual, so that he should stand up and stop me. I'm just telling you my memory of it, right? And then they did this amazing presentation, and it was live. They had computers all over. This is a long time ago. This is just a long time. It's when nothing worked. I mean, literally, nothing worked. You knew that anybody who was doing a presentation with a computer wasn't going to work. They'd have to boot it up again. It was just the way it was. It was acceptable. And it was astonishing. It was just astonishing. And it was my dream. It was a dream. And I always stayed on stage. I think I left the stage to watch it that time. I always used to stay on stage so I could stand behind people to have them stop talking. And I left the stage and watched it, and I was transplanted. I didn't think you could do that. And I said it was like flying through information, flying through understanding. It was something new. We've gotten so used to it. We see it in all the goddamn ads now. We're always flying through letters and flying through things. That was Muriel and her students. It was something that was broke through. It was a breakthrough in thinking about computer graphics and content. Not computer graphics and just graphics and pretty and flexing muscles. It was with content, content and time. And it was three-dimensional maps of time. It was all kind of aerial maps. It was Cirque du Soleil with people with printouts on them. It was special. It was really special. And I recorded. I didn't record it. I can't even type. But I had people record things. And that little video is, as far as I know, the only evidence that she and David and her students and her head and her time and her dog and her car and the, you know, and everything put that together. And it's become an icon of a moment in history when some things came together. It's like the photograph that Watson and Crick used to build their Tinker Toy model. It's a moment in time that put something together that we can stamp when people started thinking that way. And it allowed people to think differently because the tool allows you to think of things you couldn't think of except for the first person who does that. Michelangelo stands in front of a huge piece of stone and he wouldn't be able to do anything about it until somebody had invented prior to that a hammer and a chisel. And that says, well, I could let Moses out because he has a hammer and chisel. But he couldn't even think of doing that. He couldn't scrape them out with his fingernails. So her tools were these abilities to think of things that have changed our lives. Somebody came up to me before this and I forget the conversation, I forget who it was, but what came up was something I was thinking about a few weeks ago of how my life changed at a certain time when I was at Penn. I'm 82, so you can know how many years ago that was. And I was doing the student magazine then, and it was there wasn't such a thing as offset printing except by an experimental printer in downtown Philadelphia, Gene Feldman at Falcon Press. But before that, everything was done with you know, the way you set type and do it. So you couldn't think of actually doing something else. You couldn't think of all the things that Pentagram does that everybody, they wouldn't come into your head because you didn't have they couldn't be actualized. So that, they aren't the creation, but the tool allows you to think of things. And she skipped the idea that without the tool, she broke through and asked of our new inventions, do something that she was her waking dream. And we've benefited from that. Well, I won't beat that dead horse. There's a little light there, and I don't know how much time I spoke. I know I have 15 minutes, and this takes 6 minutes, and I realize I can't write better than I wrote then. It's just 6 minutes. And this was I did a book called Information Architects, and I dedicated it to Muriel many, many, many years ago. And this is what I read. I put that in the book, and this is what I read at her, at the services for her after she died. And I was with her the day before she died, or a day and a half before she died. She was at an AGI conference over in Cambridge, and we were hanging with Bobby Greenberg, she and I, and a few others. And she had to get back home. Nicholas's memory is slightly different than mine. I don't know what's right, but it doesn't make any difference what's right. She came home. And Nicholas asked her to introduce somebody, and we know that she passed away suddenly at that moment. But she showed twice the thing that you've all seen, I think, or it's around the show, or they'll show it today. I don't know what the program is today. But it was shown, we saw it live at TED. It was shown one other time afterwards, and then the last time was at the AGI conference in Cambridge. And it was remarkable for his day. So I'm going to come down here and read that. I do have 6 minutes left. Whoever's keeping time, do I still have 6 minutes? Say yes, please. Okay. Well, I'm coming here because I saw that there was more light here. Somebody turned down those lights. Okay. I'm not good at reading. I'm sorry. I'm better at talking, but this is good to read. I believe that Muriel has wings. We met. I was 29, and she was 38. We last left and planned together on the day before she was to die. I was 59, and she was 68. I knew her for 30 years. On my first meeting, I felt those wings as they wrapped around me like a mother hen. I was sharp-tongued, arrogant, coming to the MIT press trying to get my ideas published. And she walked me through the door after door that I couldn't myself navigate or open. I next saw the wings as they created a wind and showed me the wind of change. She introduced me to Nicholas and the notion of dreams, of finding your way through information, a different kind of navigation. The next wings I saw her wear, were the wings of a peace dove, as she, red-eyed and passionate, struggled to get McLuhan's book, Is Anyone Taking Any Notice, published. That poignant book about the Vietnam War and death. She wore wings on her many cardiographic exercises, flying on airplane wings, flying in space over maps, over information. Watching as the aerial perspective changed with clouds refocusing her vision of a man-created reality. The wings of triumph and the aura of discovery were all around Muriel at the TED 5 conference. She worked with David Small for 3 days to assemble together the premiere of a presentation which she, hesitantly at first, then with noticeable joy, showed to the extraordinary audience of that conference. It changed forever the visual paradigm of information for all who saw the presentation. As I came on stage holding back the tears of joy that come when you've seen something absolutely magnificent, I said, Muriel, I believe we've all had dreams of flying, and here you allowed us to make those dreams a reality as we're flying through information. It was a real-time display of heavenly navigation. Later here at the Media Lab, she once again went through the presentation with Bill Mitchell and myself as bookends, and the three of us talking to Nicholas's class. And then 3 months later, having retitled the presentation Flying Through Information, she showed the videotape to the Alliance Graphique International, AGI, at Cambridge, England. Henry Steiner, who was from Hong Kong and then president of AGI, had seen it at TED. Bob Greenberg and I spoke with her of what was going to happen next and what the dreams of flying through information released in each of us. For me, it was the ability to control one's personal understanding. That was the day before she died. I do believe Muriel has wings. They are wings that will encourage her students to be more of themselves, that will allow the people seeing her epiphanic and empowering information structure to dream of understanding. She was an architect of information. She now has the wings that few get in death. She will be in the waking dreams of those who are touched by the wind from her feathers of change and discovery.
Thank you. Can you see me? Hello? Yeah. Hello? There are two very important things that the Visible Language Workshop is looking at. One is the way in which graphics, which we define in the broadest sense, can be used to filter, define, qualify, and edit that information. And secondly, what the interface or the relation, that the surface or the access of the person to the machine can be like to promote the most creative and the most generative means of communication. And again, if you look at the computer as an environment in which you do multiple tasks, and which is ubiquitous in your life, then it's even more important that this personalization and configurability take place. Because today I may want to work on music and then go to my cookbook.
Right.
And then read my newspaper or design my newspaper. Don't go away. Where's my notes? In the back of this. Now I've lost my fucking notes. Huh? No! So, oh Jesus, here it is on the floor. Okay, don't stop. Here we go. I'm ready.
Hi, I'm Michael Beirut of Pentagram. We've assembled a panel to talk about Muriel as a designer. Like some of the other unlucky people here, I don't think I ever met Muriel. I sent her a letter in the late 70s that Rob Weisenberger found and sent me a copy of that seems to indicate that I may have met her. I don't remember writing the letter, and I don't remember what provoked me to write this letter, but I corresponded with her in some way, and so at least we have that remote connection. But her influence, as Nicholas said, is so broad and so deep that almost anyone practicing graphic design today would say that they have somehow met Muriel Cooper. We've got three people who can talk about this in more depth. Aaron Vinegar, who's a professor at the University of Oslo and the author of several books, including I Am a Monument, which is about Muriel and her work on Learning from Las Vegas, the epical volume by Denise Scott Brown and Robert Venturi. Ben Fry, the creator of the programming environment processing. I'm sorry. You need a better catchier name than that, Venice.
Yeah. I'm just basic. Being. Something.
Yeah. Basic. He's a winner of the National Design Award from the Cooper Hewitt Museum for interaction design, as is at least one other speaker here this evening. And then finally, Ellen Lupton, who is the senior curator for contemporary design at the National Design Museum. And so she's the person who sort of hands out those awards. And I will point out this very evening is the evening of the National Design Awards in New York City. Ellen is honor bound to be there, but instead, here. So that just shows where the priorities are when Muriel Cooper has something to say about them. So I'd like to invite Ellen to talk Muriel and her
That's
legacy.
That's great. I did get to meet Muriel. Very profound. And I was in the audience when Ricky didn't take his shoes off, but she did and showed that amazing video. And I was trying to think, what would she have made of this today? All of you here, a giant book about her work, an honorary elevator button, her name typeset in 35,000 point purple Helvetica. I think she would have liked it. You know, girls are supposed to be embarrassed by all the attention, but I'll tell you a secret. We like it. It's good. It's good. And what would she have thought about the world of media today, this exploding, uncontrolled, metastatic, networked mess of digital communication? She said it all. She really knew what was happening. And it's been a great pleasure to kind of think again about her work and to read the wonderful essays about her voice and her students in the book that Rob and David put together. Muriel can't be here today, but I want her to be here. And so I pulled together some of her words because she needs to speak. And she was so articulate about the questions that obsess people like me and Michael. What is a book? What is an author? What is the role of graphic designers in all of that? What is the nature of communication? And what is it that we do, damn it, that adds value to communication? I pulled out a couple of her most stunning and important or famous books, but they're the books in which she had the most role as an author. And in her decades at MIT and her role at MIT Press, she was creating systems and ways that books could kind of generate themselves. But she also really got her fingers and hands and mind into certain books that very much bear her stamp as a co-author of information. She thought that books were like movies. She wanted to eliminate the gap between the designer and the process of printing and shaping information. So she played with offset as this kind of live medium, a motion medium. She used the grid in her amazing Bauhaus book as a way to give structure and architecture, but also to create constant change and surprise. My favorite part is the index. I'm sure she spent a lot of time on that index. And I think this is actually the manuscript for the Bauhaus book. This is what we do. We take a pile of shit like that, right? These thousands of pages. That is not a book. It is not a book until someone comes through and gives it shape and makes it accessible to human beings to find their way in and out. And she talked about that. She talked about graphic design as a kind of filtering of this mess, the stream of information, the junk that authors hand us and that we make into something coherent. And she saw that the future would give readers and writers better ways to find their way through information, to give it a better shape. And she was interested in information that should go away. She didn't feel that everything should stay on the planet forever, and she thought that designers had a role in making data disappear. I wish more people had paid attention to that. I think that's really important. And in this book, which Aaron will talk about more, we can kind of see the battle for authorship between two great women of design theory and thinking, Muriel Cooper and Denise Scott Brown, the real author and the graphic design author. And Muriel, I think, was frustrated by being told what to do by the author. And she created this incredible book that provided a kind of new interface for connecting image and text, for allowing us to absorb the image as a kind of text, and to kind of fit those things together in an incredibly eloquent way. So if you come in close to this book, you'll see that that wide letting made space for these little figure numbers, which are keyed to the pictures, and it allowed the reader to go back and forth between the text and the image in an absolutely brilliant way. Apparently, Denise Scott Brown didn't like that very much. And there exist in the papers of Muriel Cooper interchanges between these two great women fighting about the book. And Denise thought it was too interesting, too Bauhaus, too much noise of the graphic designer in there. And what she wanted was something more conventional, which is what she got later, right? I'll let Muriel have the last word on that, talking about the author. And you can see here the kind of frustration of graphic designers feeling boxed in and told what to do. And what she really wanted is for us to all have tools to be authors and designers and publishers. And boy, did we get those tools. Okay?
Yeah.
Boom. Thank you.
Ellen, thank you.
Thank you very much. I came to Muriel Cooper's work directly through her design work. I never met her in person. I first encountered, actually, when I started working on Learning from Las Vegas, like many people, I first encountered the book on the right, which is the revised version, the boring version, I guess, that was designed by Denise Scott Brown, and then worked myself back to the original version designed by Muriel Cooper. And I guess I was kind of stunned by her approach to design and vision, which I initially, you know, was directed towards the design work, this kind of complicated, I think prefiguring her later interest in the visible language workshop on texture, layering, transparency, a kind of dynamism to the text, interrelations between text and image. As Ellen said, you can see the extreme leading, the triple spacing of the main text juxtaposed by the very tight text in the margins and so forth. Here's another example of the layout of Muriel Cooper's design. And then you can see the difference that Denise Scott Brown really did not like the Swiss treatment of her book and really wanted a much more boring, or she called it deadpan, approach to the book with very regularized text and image. The images grouped together here. Here you can see the use of the grid. This was drawn for me by Sally Steiner. And showing you the grid that Muriel Cooper used. And then again, this image, which was also supposed to kind of replicate the movement through the city, and the lines of the text are kind of the roadways or the highways, and the numbering of the images are meant to be like signs. So your way of reading is like moving through the city. And this kind of sense of movement is also kind of demonstrated in these layouts. This is a layout for part one of Learning from Las Vegas. So Muriel Cooper could see the arrangements of text and image and flow and so forth. And the filmic dimension is really important here. But I think I want to mention what I learned from her, what I think about her work that's important. And this is the kind of triadic relationship between communication, movement, and experience. And I think I have a little bit of a different attitude to what communication is, perhaps than traditional designers. I'm not a designer. And to me, communication is exposing us to the risk of experience. That means traversing something, pushing against limits, undergoing something. And this kind of attitude towards experience really is about discovering a path. It's not formulating a method. It is not deploying kind of preconceived formats, whether those are grids or not. It is really the exposure for us to experience something new and to undergo it, not to have an experience, but to, and not to own it or anything like that, but to actually undergo it and move along a path. So a hodos, a path. Method is the word method. Consists of the word hodos, which is path. And I don't think she ever deployed anything, you know, preconceived, although, of course, she was deploying Swiss kind of graphic design, but the kind of material spills out over this. And I think what she brought to her further work, Invisible Language Workshop, is that the book was undergoing a really rapid change in 1972. Things were opening up, and this was a site of experiment. The book was no longer an archaic stillness, but was being opened up and kind of proliferating by the work of people like, you know, designers at the time and theorists and so forth. And Muriel Cooper was at the forefront of that. And that kind of issue about movement and information and complexity, a book isn't just to be read for information, but something like the size of the Learning from Las Vegas book, the original version, you can't sit there and read it, right? You need to place it on a table. You need to move it around, explore it, move through the information. And this kind of attitude gets carried on and carried forth in her later work with the Visible Language Workshop. But a lot of that was enabled by her exploration of book design, I think. So that's what I was impressed with her work and my encounter with her work.
Thanks, Aaron. Ben.
So I don't typically read when doing a talk. I've been ill lately and I have a four-month-old at home, and so I have the memory of a mosquito. And I want to make sure that, you know, this sort of give the subject its due here. So at the risk of dating myself, I think I probably saw the work of Muriel in the VLW first in a Wired magazine. A couple years later, I was this senior at Carnegie Mellon, and recent VLW alum Suguru Ishizaki brought Dave Small and John Maida to speak, and this was the first time that I saw how my interest in graphic design and computer science might actually be combined in a more interesting way than just sort of, you know, jamming them together. As a student, I'd already worked professionally as a graphic designer and separately as a software developer, but I'd always kind of hated computer graphics. Because I found them to represent everything I despised about the usual collision of art and engineering, a bunch of engineers trying to replicate a Mondrian painting and calling it art, or 3D graphics with spheres and cubes and incandescent RGB colors, so synthetic and alien that they hardly seem at home with the computer itself. I love that Muriel remained a designer first, and it shows the influence of her work as seen in her students. Often when designers start working with computation as a medium, there's a tendency to shut off their design instincts because they're in this foreign and sort of technical space. To make the transition, you really need to think, keep your critical eye and treat computation as just another medium that is, you know, as imperfect as any other, and learn from its working within its constraints by also trying to challenge yourself to overcome them. Muriel did this with her students with the VLW exploring things like depth of field and blur and anti-alias text many years before these would become commonplace. These came from an approach grounded in fields like photography and film and typography and a desire to make this cold medium a little bit more humanistic. In 2001, I'd been a student of John Maida's for 3 years and began working with Casey Reese on what would become Processing, a project that seeks to make it easier to merge these disciplines of design and code. And it is a direct descendant of coding libraries that date to the VLW, plus the pedagogical side of what we did at the ACG. And finally, the desire to sketch with code, so writing short programs that are easily iterated upon the same way that you work in your sketchbook. The VLW name even lives on as the font format used by Processing, which stores information in exactly the same way as the type used in that information landscapes video we saw earlier. Millions of users later, we have a mission statement for the Processing project, which reads, "Processing seeks to ruin the careers of talented designers by tempting them away from their usual tools and into the world of programming and computation. Similarly, the project is designed to turn engineers and computer scientists to less gainful employment as artists and designers." And I hope that point would resonate with Muriel. After she took a class with Nicholas Negroponte, she's quoted to have said that the code on screen didn't make any goddamn sense. I've always felt that these are precisely the people that I want to bring into the field. The technically inclined will always find their way regardless, and but they'll also make things that are more suited to their technical interests. And so a field gets interesting, however, only really truly evolves when it expands by bringing in people with different abilities and kinds of experiences. And as far as accessibility, we've come a long way since the VLW era, where this work was limited to research labs using computers the size of a mini fridge. By the early 2000s, you could buy a computer for a few $100s to do this type of work, which meant that the means was in place. We just provided the platform, or we just needed to provide the platform, which Casey and I sought to do with processing. And now in the current decade, the means is ubiquitous, and processing continues with newer initiatives like the P5JS project, which takes the same ideas and tries to rethink them for, you know, sort of contemporary web setting. But more importantly, Lauren McCarthy has led the project with a renewed focus on inclusion and diversity, meaning that we're at a point where we have more room to consider what this means socially and how we can really extend the boundary of those participating in the field. The evolution over the last couple decades reminds me of a wonderful John Adams quote. Paraphrase goes something like, "I must study politics so that my sons may have liberty to study mathematics and philosophy, and my sons will study geography and commerce and agriculture to give their children the right to study painting, poetry, music, and architecture." We owe an enormous debt to Muriel and her students for providing this basis for us, and I'm honored to be participating today. Thank you.
When Ellen and then Aaron were talking about the tension that occurred between Muriel Cooper and Denise Scott Brown in the design and production of Learning from Las Vegas, one of the things that actually throws in a sharp relief is that period when authors actually did turn over to designers a pile of manuscript that looked like that photograph that Ellen showed, and then there was no choice but to have a designer or some appointed professional with arcane technical skills, mm-hmm. knowing the names of typefaces, knowing how to do color separations and how to create mechanical artwork that could communicate intention to a printer. all of those things were like, you know, what Abbott Miller calls black arts in a way, that like civilians didn't know and weren't meant to know, and certainly authors were not meant to know or even have an opinion about. And so hence that collision was so acute, I think. Now, as Ben just said, now we're in a period where indeed the means of production are in everyone's hands. And is it for the better, do you think, Ben?
No question. Because I think the, again, it's, it only gets interesting as you bring the other kinds of people into it. And so it's kind of a, you know, you have people who come in who are beginners, but they're experts somewhere else. And so I think it's really fascinating to take somebody who has that, you know, something that they are expert at, but they're, you know, kind of bringing that into something new. And that's only, you know, and so the idea that the, where Muriel was bringing things like from typography or from, you know, just obvious things like, you know, so for somebody who's worked with film or photography, that motion blur and depth of field are just, you know, the norm. But for somebody who's thinking about things from a, you know, engineering perspective, well, I'm trying to get the shapes on screen, you know, and it's like, well, so being able to kind of merge those things together in a way that, you know, it's just, that's what you get at that sort of, that intersection, essentially. And so I think the only way you can do that is mm-hmm. get as many people as possible kind of using, you know, using these kinds of tools and making messes with them first.
Yeah. Aaron?
Just a clarification. This is not an answer to that question, but a bit of a detail. With the Learning from Las Vegas book, it definitely wasn't dumping a pile of papers.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Like, these are people who had very strong, Denise Scott Brown, Robert Venturi, had very strong design ideas and thought of themselves as designers.
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
So it was very overdeveloped or thought about in kind of very specific ways by the time it arrived there.
And, that's interesting. And this takes us down a kind of dangerously arcane graphic design road, but
love it.
And you're
Let's
in favor
go.
Of that, Ellen. Good. I think it's easy if you're a graphic designer to look at Muriel's design for that book as being the designed one, and for to look at the second, the revised edition, and the one that I, in fact, first saw and only knew for many years
Most
as being
people.
Sort of like this yeah. undesigned piece of crap that was like done, put together by untutored people. But when I you know, the intention behind it was very, very powerful in term, and Denise Scott Brown's objections to Muriel's design were really articulated and very, you know, like, can you sort of like describe what Denise wanted out of that book?
I think it's all a matter of timing. So actually, it's odd because much is made of the conflict between Muriel Cooper and Denise Scott Brown. As Muriel Cooper said, it was a battle of wits, yeah. You know, and it was a real kind of a real conflict. But you know, they had many things in common. Mm. I could go through them. It's interest in movement. They both were interested in multiple graphic modes of representing or accounting for sensory plenitude and information landscapes. I could go on and on. Yeah. So why was the conflict? And of course, a lot of it is about timing and so forth. You know, that second book, you could say, is a treatise.
Yeah.
It's an idea of a text. It wants to be a book.
Yeah.
You know, it wants to, you know, get across a set of premises or polemics. Right, and the first
it's also
book,
more accessible
and accessible.
Yeah. It's a little paper bag, yeah.
Inexpensive.
Can put in your
I'm keeping away from the more pragmatic economic things like that.
But that's key, I think, as a reader. Much as I love the big book,
yeah.
But
I don't want to actually interact with it that much.
But the other one was a kind of sense of the text, or what you know J.J. Gibson would call a sensory ecology, mm-hmm. that you don't get text purified of its. You know, sensory plenitude, and that's what you get in the first book is a kind of a sense of the text. In the second book, you get the idea of a text or a treatise, yeah. or a polemic. And those are kind of different desires. But, you know, originally, Denise Scott Brown, they wanted a huge book right at the beginning. So, you know,
they got it.
The kind of, yeah, belatedly. And so these kinds of sense of timings and what you want to kind of achieve polemically with your body of work shifts over time.
And what's interesting, of course, is that that's the revised edition, there's nothing to do with that book except read it, right? Like looking at it, it's no fun, for me at least. You know, yeah, there's some plates in it that you can look at, but basically you have no choice. But if you want to engage with that book, you have one way to do it, which is reading it. Whereas I would maintain the first edition and newly re-released is you can really engage with that book without actually reading it and without actually perceiving any of the ideas, in fact. And people will, you know, have done and will do that. So there's, mm-hmm. I think I sort of get, I mean, those two ways of looking at text is really pronounced. And I think it's so one of the things that I wonder is, was she a reader? Was she frustrated by kind of the linear nature of a traditional book, and you know that information landscape? So you know, I mean,
I didn't get the opportunity to work with.
Yeah, but I mean, do you get a sense
I think what's interesting about the information landscape thing and that. Richard touched on it earlier as far as this idea of how you actually move through a space of information. And I think it's kind of the, for people who, you know, like working with information, that's kind of, these are the things that like roll around in their heads, our heads, and keep us up at night. And so I think that was the kind of thing that's kind of rolling around for her, and that this is like, this is just, you know, the way it's working in her head. And then when she makes a, you know, a layout for a book like the Las Vegas book, that's kind of a moment frozen in time of that picture that's been, it's been in constant motion, and then all of a sudden, here's this snapshot that we're, you know, putting out in front of people. And so I think that sort of thing, you know, is really what comes through is how do you capture that motion and movement through the information.
And, you know, I think Nicholas and Ricky both kind of referred to the revelatory quality of that presentation of information landscapes, particularly the first time at TED 5. And what strikes me, if you sort of see it today, it's, you know, there's not a single kind of, you know, candy bar commercial on television that doesn't use some sort of, you know, kind of move that kind of first saw the light of day and that thing. I mean, and so have we reached some sort of, you know, endpoint, Ellen, as a curator of Canterbury Design, were you some sort of endpoint where, like, you know, where now we await the next thing, the next kind of transformation, which may be just emojis or something? I don't know.
Well, I think, you know, now we're talking about, you know, having text everywhere on our glasses and that we're going to look around and everything is going to have text all over it. I think I'm waiting for that.
With enthusiasm?
Sure. yeah, I think that there is always this hunger for more and different, but I do think that that paradigm of the information landscape from that conference, you know, what was it, 30 years ago, was like a profound moment because it wasn't just layers of text that were parallel to the screen, but the fact of this moving like this was mind-blowing because it was just taking the perspective in a different way.
Also, I think what
and then it was live text. Yeah. It wasn't pictures of text. It was actual language that could be edited.
I think also a lot of what you see in the advertising and sort of the versions of this that are really pervasive are really kind of the side effect of it. You know, love when type moves around in 3D on a screen, and like we're very drawn to it, and we're really drawn to language and things like that. But I think the fundamental kinds of issues that Muriel and the VLW were going after as far as how do you actually move through a space of information? How do you actually interact with it? How do you, you know, understand this? We're still a long ways off from actually, you know, fixing a lot more of those core ideas. And how do we, you know, spend more more time kind of focused on unpacking some of those issues that they had just kind of started to scratch the surface of?
I think sometimes when the argument is how she progressed from book design to the VLW, that it was a limit. The book was too still, like, you know, all kinds of things that stayed were kind of intervening on the kinds of movement or that she wanted. But I actually think some of that stillness remained in the design, and I think that's what's been lost, this kind of gap or temporal gap between the acquisition of data and the plane of discovery, and those have been compressed. And here with her work, you always had that the time to do that, and that temporal kind of extension or duration has been rapidly closing, and I think that's an issue, or what gives her work that kind of interest or depth, I think.
Yeah, and I think when I look at her, at Muriel Cooper's later work, when it's the screen-based work and the digital work, it always really seems to have like, if not a literary route to it, at least it's sort of thought, it's you understand that the information is meant to be understood and interpreted. And I think if you sort of want to take it right up to the present day, you know, one of the reasons that we have this crisis of, you know, what is truth and what is fake news is that information comes to people from all sorts of different angles, links to things, you know.
It always looks good.
Yeah, and things are linked off of things, and they all look legitimate. They're all sort of coming out of the same pipe, and people make up their own minds about what's true or not. And I think that that sort of is, you know, that the authorial, the you know, the authority that that authors bring to things. No mistake, those words I think have the same root. You know, which the difference between a treatise and a pile of manuscript is sort of, I think, a little bit what, you know, that gap is defines the confusion that pervades the world today. Comments? Yeah, please. No, go ahead, Ricky. Yeah.
It's a live thing, and that's quite literary and quite intentful. And that conversation with the page and the kind of Talmudic sense of having a talk to each other was quite important. And that wasn't just a picture.
Yeah. Yeah, so Ricky points out, if you didn't hear it, that it was really an attempt to create a conversation on the page, a conversation with the text, and sort of the ideal almost of Talmudic commentary on a set text. And there's, you know, I would guess there are some authors that actually don't like that, that don't want to have a conversation. They just like to have the
leave me alone. Yeah.
Leave me alone and let me just say my piece and read it all the way through. And that wasn't Muriel's point of view. Muriel's point of view, I think, was to enable people to access TESS in a lot of different ways and to interact with it, right, actively. So is there one big lesson that we could learn from Muriel today that would solve our problems as a currently bedeviled Ellen?
I think she really, what was really driving so much of her work was the desire to break down the mediation between authorship and getting it out there. And the idea that you could have direct access to both the content and its delivery. I think that was just a driving thing, that she wanted to get rid of that person you have to call up and ask, you know, oh, I have a typo, will you fix it? Right? People don't want to have to do that. They don't want to have to call Michael Beirut and say, fix my typo. They just want to be able to fix it. Yeah. And I think that desire to get rid of that mediation was really profound for her and is really important to me as an author who also uses InDesign.
Yeah.
I want to fix my own typos. Thank you, Muriel.
Yeah. Hey, Ben, Aaron?
So most of my work is about, you know, sort of understanding and working with information and basically this idea of, you know, there's this mess of information out there and that design is essentially the lens through which, you know, the only lens through which we're actually going to get understanding out of it. And as far as I'm concerned, you know, Muriel really represents sort of a patron saint of that type of thinking and that way of how, you know, how an individual actually interacts with the information as mediated by, you know, by code and by the computer as a digital tool. So
yeah,
that's remarkable.
Yeah, for me, I think it's that communication is not just conveying information, but it, as I said, exposing us to the risk of experience,
yeah.
And that it's a, as you pointed out, a conversation, an encounter, those kinds of things are precious and need to be fostered, and that illegibilities and incommunicabilities are not external errors, but they're generated internally. And those are productive of some of our most interesting encounters. So when those texts are shifting, there's certain points where a palimpsest happens, where it erases information and just doesn't reveal it. And those are important points. And those, I think those opacities, blind spots, illegibilities are being kind of wiped out. And we need to find new ways of preserving those kinds of things, difficulties.
Well, I'd like to thank our panel, Aaron Vinegar, Ben Fry, Ellen Lupton. Please join me. Thank you very much.
That was great.
Thank you.
This is an unscheduled introduction because I'm not supposed to be doing it, but I thought you would like to know something which John might not tell you. When we opened up the Media Lab in 1985, one of the less colorful groups was an advanced television program, which was a very engineering approach to high definition and stuff like that. And there was this young graduate student from electrical engineering named John Maeda, who was awfully unhappy with his 6'2" Germanic heel-clicking advisor. And he says, oh, I'm so unhappy and I really want to be an artist. And for one reason or another, he drops out, he goes to Japan. I think his parents may have blamed me or other people, but they weren't happy. And John goes to Japan, end of story. 9 years later, Muriel dies. 1994, May 28th. And after recovering, which you can't really do very easily, we set up a search, an international search, for who could replace Muriel Cooper? Well, the answer is nobody can replace Muriel Cooper, but who could we get that would be somewhat in the same domain? And this was not a fixed, wired search. This was a real, honest, global search. And boop, John Maeda appears from Japan and applies, comes here, gives the talk, and won that search hands down, and came back as a faculty member, which I'm sure his parents also loved us for, and now that you were back. So, John?
Thank you. Wow, that was a nice introduction. I am a dropout. It's true. Also a faculty dropout now, too. I have a few presentation slides because I thought it should be visual. I arrived roughly 3 hours ago and began in the lobby to make a presentation. And I was trying to understand like what I could say to all of you, because I know you'd all be here. So first of all, who knew Muriel? Raise your hand. Okay, so those who didn't know Muriel, did her work change you in any tiny way? Come on, those who didn't know. Yeah, you didn't know, but you just kind of like, can I hit you? Grace Colby over there just threw a button at me. It changed her life as a student. And I see so many students here of Muriel's. You'll get to see Dave Small later. Where's Dave? Dave's going to be talking later. Like Dave was that sort of magical link between what Muriel's group did and what my group did. And I feel very lucky. Okay, let's bring up the information. Okay, I don't have a heavy, fancy pentagram video. Oh, video problem. Oh, no problem. Okay, so first of all, I want to note something that Ben Fry didn't mention. Where's Ben? Ben over there. Thank you. Press play. Yeah, it'll come. Ben, where are you, Ben? Ben, come on, you're back there. So I arrived here at the Media Lab, and I had to like find students. That's something you have to do when you become a Media Lab professor. And I had no experience doing that. So what I began to do was I was surfing all kind of websites, looking for people, kind of like, you know, an X-Men or something, trying to find the mutants that can do the visual and can do the code. And I located this one person named Ben Fry, who was at this nominal company called Netscape. They were trying to make this thing, it was never going to take off, whatever. But somehow I convinced Ben to leave that early stage startup, sorry, Ben, to come to the Media Lab. A year later or so, a gentleman appeared named Casey Rees, who told me that he really wanted to come here. He was a graphic designer, but didn't know how to code. And so I said, well, you're going to have to learn how to code. And he said, what do I have to learn? You have to learn C++, you have to learn OpenGL. And he said, And wrote it down in his notebook. I got to tell you, I tell like all kind of people that same thing, and they go, and never come back. But a year later, Casey shows up with his laptop, and he says, hi. I said, you came back. And he says, yeah, after I met you, I quit my job. And he was at a dot-com thing, a really good one. And he quit his job and began focusing on computation, and it blew me away. So I just want to say that this place is very special. And this place really happened because of a few people in this room, but most notably Nicholas over here, who had this vision that, like a George Clooney-style Ocean's 11 or something, that this mix of people could create something. And I think that catalyzing force is so powerful, because yesterday I was at Sponsor Day. You know Sponsor Day? It's like special private viewing of things. And so I was blown away. First of all, I was seeing Neri Oxman's stuff, and it was like amazing. I was sitting over there. I was like, oh, Neri, you're like blowing my mind. Like, whoa, you can do that now? And I also saw Gloriana, special cameo. And Joe Paradiso was showing his like weird stuff, which is always good. It's like, you know, a lot of bass and mysterious and sensors and everywhere. And I saw also, I'm turning to my left and there's like Hugh's legs. I'm like, okay, cool, right? And then I saw Chris Matt. Now, Chris is the person who invented the car navigation system, right? If you imagine, like, the Media Lab saw all these things, had these ideas. They were outlandish at the time. Why would you ever need your car to tell you where to go? Right? And of course, my dear friend Hiroshi Ishii, I got to see his lab. Hiroshi makes everything like vibrate and shake and whatever. And so I had a great time. I felt very Media Lab-y. Wow, the stuff you can see here. But I came here today for Muriel. I also saw the special, like, you know, branded floor. I was a little bit early, and I don't have a place here anymore, so I hung out in the lobby, just sitting there, in the Wiesner sort of like special place. Who knew Jerry Wiesner? Who knew this person? So an amazing figure of MIT, stood for world peace, like really important stuff, right? So I just hung out there and worked. And as I worked there, it's great because when you're in this little place, suddenly you see all the details, right? Because I've been here like 4 or 5 times, but by sitting there, I was like in a video conference and like, wait, there's a picture. And I saw this picture. And this is like a really good picture. This is like a good picture, right? And when I saw this picture, it reminded me of what, to me, MIT meant. Because I really had never heard of design when I came to MIT. I was a classical engineering student. My parents didn't have much money or education. So just coming here was the whole goal. By the time I got here, I wasn't sure what to do. But I remembered looking at the Media Lab and thinking, well, that's a really weird place. That seems very unconventional, very impractical. You know, like it's a big format. It's got images everywhere. I don't understand it. Let's make it cheaper and simpler, right? And I was like, I don't know what that was. And I was talking to the person at the front. There was a person from Member Relations. And Sharon.
Who is she? What did she do?
I just recently found out.
What'd you find out?
Oh my God.
Because she like knows everything in the Media Lab. You can ask her anything in the front desk. So I said, who's Muriel Cooper? And she wasn't sure. So we cut the camera then. And then we did cut two.
Famous person. With a wonderful legacy.
Yeah, how does someone have a wonderful legacy? What's the secret?
Passion, enthusiasm, probably a little bit of arrogance, and persistence.
Wow. What's your name?
I'm Sharon.
A little applause for Sharon, right? You just kind of nailed it. And I thought about these things, these four words, and I thought about passion. And to Nicholas's point, you know, I did have this very special professor here at the Media Lab who made my life a little bit difficult. In retrospect, I'm very grateful, of course. Everything is better in hindsight. But I decided to leave, but I didn't know what to do. And Muriel told me to go to art school. And it was the best advice to give to me. She said that I wouldn't learn what I was wanting to learn at a technical school because I had done all the technical education. The problem in engineering education is you learn how to build anything, but you don't know what to build or why to build it. And so by going to art school, it really changed my life, really. So I thank Muriel. Now, this word enthusiasm is interesting because something about enthusiasm is something that you might have as a rising person, someone who's trying to figure stuff out. And enthusiastic people tend to need aspirational people, right? Like, how many people had a hero? Come on, you had a hero. We had heroes. And so that hero was someone who was aspirational. And my friend told me recently, Jesse, my dear friend, an artist, told me how aspiration and inspiration are two different things. Aspiration is what you're trying to see and you understand. Inspiration is what awakens inside you and is the fire that someone else gave you through having that aspirational being. So, well, I remember like leaving here, not sure what to do, in Japan, I rebuilt my career as a designer. I came back to the computer and figured out that this skill I had to make code, to Ben's point, I knew what to make suddenly. It was so much easier. And I began publishing things in Japan, and I made this little book called The Reactive Square, which is 10 squares that respond to sound delivered on a floppy disk. I know, very ancient. But I remember like, oh, this kind of feels sort of right, you know? And I remember emailing Muriel and saying, hey, I think I figured it out. And she wrote back to me and said, show me. And then a month later, she passed away. So I remember when I heard there was this call for someone to somehow come here, I thought, I can never do that. That's impossible. But I'd love to show my respect. And what happened is, the day before I came to the Media Lab to give a faculty talk, I was visiting this idol that I had, Paul Rand. Again, I didn't know about design when I came to MIT. Once I saw the Media Lab's world, I thought, oh, I want to learn more about it, learn more about design. And I found a book by Paul Rand by accident in the MIT's Rhodes Visual Library. I don't know if it's still here, but I was like, whoa, what is this book? This book is so fascinating. Ah, design, really interesting. I think I want to do this. Well, anyways, years later, in Japan, the Paul Rand of Japan, Ikko Tanaka, befriended me and said, hey, if you're going to the United States, you should visit my friend Paul Rand. I said, cool. So I went to visit Mr. Rand, and the next day was my faculty talk. So what a good day to do like any job talk, right? I was like so happy. I like met my dream person. So when I came here, I wasn't nervous, luckily. I should have been nervous. But anyways, that was a big moment. And so when I arrived at MIT, I asked Nicholas if we could bring Paul Rand. And I remember Nicholas said, Paul Rand, is he still alive? Is he still around? I said, oh, yeah, he's around. And we were worried if people would come to see Paul Rand talk. And Paul made it much more difficult by saying he wanted to speak at 10 a.m. And Nicholas might not remember this, but Nicholas said, no one's going to come at 10 a.m., 4 p.m. Have him come at 4 p.m. I said, oh, can you come at 4 p.m.? Professor Negroponte says, no, I'm coming at 10 a.m. If no one's going to show up at 4 p.m., I never wanted to talk to them anyways. So he showed up at 10 a.m., and I'm sure Nicholas remembers the auditorium was packed. It was standing room only. It was an incredible outpouring for Mr. Rand and design in general, which was exciting. Arrogance. I loved that moment when she says arrogance, and everyone kind of like bristled with like, yeah, you know, but there's that Bob Sutton book about, you know, the no assholes, you know, but wait a second, I don't understand this. Well, it's a fact that artists might appear arrogant, but as when I ran Rhode Island School of Design, I was able to work with many artists, and I found this one thing I didn't understand at the beginning. I used to visit all the lunchrooms and bring my food around and sit with students randomly to see if they let me sit with them. Sometimes I'd say, no, don't sit with us. And like, oh, come over here, you know? But one day there was this young woman say, come here, come. I said, oh no, she wants to sit with me. So I sat with her and she's saying, you know, I'm a freshman. I thought, oh no, complaints, it's coming, something's coming. I'm a freshman and it was really hard that first semester. You know, I come from the Midwest, this is all new to me, I didn't understand it, didn't understand the teachers, it was just so hard. Every day I just didn't know what to do. And she said, now I'm in the second term, and I know where things are, I know what kind of questions to ask, it's all working really well, but I have to have confession to make. I said, oh no, confession. I have to confess that I don't feel alive. And so I remember like walking back to my office and the elevator opened and my friend Jessie, she was the provost at the time, she was right there. I said, Jessie, this interesting thing happened to me. I was sitting with this young woman and she was saying this thing. And Jessie looked at me and said, well, of course, she's an artist. An artist doesn't feel alive unless they feel the struggle. It's through that struggle that they feel alive. So it may look like arrogance, but it's that strength to be different that I see is there. And lastly, persistence, right? What a good one to end on. Think about it. I mean, when you tell like younger people today that there was a time when there was this like dot matrix typeface, not like, you know, an anti-alias version of it, but like 5 dots by 7 dots was all you got. And I'm now a product manager, design lead at a company where I'm trying to tell everyone, like, do this. No, you, that's not the way you have to do it. Do it this way, it's better. No, I think it's good this way. It gives me a sense of how easy it is now compared to when Muriel was able to convince people that maybe you need this thing called Helvetica on screen. Maybe it has to be anti-alias, so it looks much more smooth to the eye, pleasurable. So that kind of persistence, I can't imagine how hard it was for her and the team back then to do what has happened, but look how amazing information is today on our devices. So persistence, good persistence. So all I can say now is I am at the very end, and I'm 00 seconds, and I want to leave with this thought that Muriel was one of the great teachers, and all of you are teachers in different ways too. So please consider yourselves as intellectual philanthropists, people that can give this away to other people. They give opportunities. And I used to raise money, so I will do a thing for MIT Press. If you have not bought this book or aren't buying it yet, buy many for your friends, because it's a way to carry Muriel's legacy forward. Thank you.
I'm going to introduce you guys. So give me 2 seconds, because I also have to say one other word, which you guys may not know, but there's apparently a new fund that's been created by the Wade family. I believe it's Emily and Jephtha. Is anybody here from the Wade family? No? Well, at any rate, it's a new fund at the MIT Press, which will bear Muriel's name. And its purpose, as I understand it, is to help make the art and architecture and design books easier to do and subventure them and do whatever. And yours is the first. So we not only want to hear about the book, but you should know it's the first of the Muriel Cooper Fund. I guess it's a little nepotistic for it to be funding the Muriel book, but at any rate, please come. I guess they read your names and their things.
All right, sure. No, thank you. Thank you, Nicholas. My name is Rob Wiesenberger. This is David Reinfurt. We're co-authors of this book, which we hope you'll see soon, entitled Muriel Cooper. And we just wanted to make a few very basic observations about the book, about its structure, about the intent behind it. Before that, we wanted to thank the MIT Press for its enthusiasm about the project, for investing in it, thank the Media Lab for hosting, and thank so many people in this room, from the family and the colleagues and friends of Cooper's, the archivists, the librarians, all of these people who helped make this material come alive for us. So just a couple words on this this book. The first observation is pretty straightforward about its scale, and hopefully you'll appreciate it. It's a big book, and we were really happy to see that this book can stand up beside Cooper's two great tomes, The Bauhaus of 1969, after which this book takes some inspiration visually, and Learning from Las Vegas of 1972, which is mercifully back in print. So we really like that this book can hold its own, this book dedicated to Cooper, beside those two great tomes, and that this book is also about the person who helped take us beyond the book, so it feels appropriate. When you get into the book, you'll see that the epigraph, to start off with, is a sort of confession of Cooper's, and she says, I guess I'm never sure that print is truly linear. I guess I'm never sure that print is truly linear. And she said this in the 90s when she's already working in the digital realm. And it's to us, it seemed like a nice way to start a book because it's a kind of, it's a statement of ambivalence. It's a statement, very typically of Cooper, it's a statement of ambivalence, it's a statement of possibility as well. She's just gotten done explaining the specificity of the printed book versus the possibilities of the digital, and then she backtracks and says, actually, I guess I'm never sure that print is truly linear. And so it seemed like an appropriately self-reflexive way to start a book, but also appropriate to her, who felt, even as she moved into the digital world, that the book was a specific kind of technology. The Codex book had its own set of possibilities. Simultaneity for her versus linearity, she really strove for simultaneity. Not that you start here and end here, but in all of her work, whether it was a highly layered image that comes at you all at once or can be accessed in different ways, or a video disc that you can skip around from, based on your own path, or the hyperlinking of the world we now live in, simultaneity, non-linearity was so important to Cooper, and I think she showed that books can do that. And so we kind of wanted to start with this very equivocal and self-reflexive acknowledgement of the power that books still actually hold that she showed to us. Very, very sort of basic observation, but in the table of contents, we separated out, there's a text portion and an image portion, and that's the structure of the Bauhaus book that Cooper designed as well. I mean, she inherited that from its German predecessor, but we both wrote essays on her early and late work respectively, her work in print and software respectively, and they're essays, they're attempts, they're brief, and then we show you the work. And we really wanted to foreground the work and let people enter in either direction. And we think that, you know, at different times, maybe the text will be galvanizing for people, her words. At other times, the images will be. At other times, still, the images may feel dated, and then they'll feel new again. So we wanted to provide these two ways of accessing it. And you'll see that there are these two texts, and then there are these three sections, we call them portfolio sections, and they respectively, they represent her work. They are design and teaching and research. And they were successive categories in her career. She did them one after another. And of course, they bleed into one another. They're not such crisp distinctions. But the point I wanted to make that struck us about Cooper was that design and teaching and research, we didn't write those categories, that she did. And that I think we've heard tonight that her career intersected with a lot of interesting people. It's actually Paul Rand, who we just heard about, who recommended her for a job at the MIT Press. It's great design luminary Georgie Kepisch before that, who brought her on to MIT. She designed the Bauhaus book when Herbert Beyer, the great Bauhaus master, wasn't available. She's at the MIT Media Lab with a whole set of luminaries, many of whom are in this room. And yet she designed and redesigned her own career in really interesting ways. So these chapters, design and teaching and research, we quote her in the book as saying, you know, I very deliberately decided I no longer wanted to be a designer in a traditional sense. And she uses the word deliberately about three times in a sentence or two. And that idea of the deliberate, the purposive, the intentional, that she was forging her way, creating careers in fields that simply didn't exist, with a lot of assists from the brilliant minds around her, but that she wrote these chapters. So the last thing I wanted to say is, it's striking when you hear about, when we hear about Muriel tonight, I mean, we didn't know her personally, and we're very aware of that. I mean, I was 10 when she died. David will tell his passing connection, but you know, we didn't know her, and we respect all of the help of those who did, and we want to provide this way in. And it's striking that she's simultaneously, by everyone's account, this kind of firecracker, this incredible personality, so idiosyncratic, and yet is not well known and didn't really have the time in her own life because she was working so hard. Often behind the scenes, to really consolidate her work in a clear way and say, this is my career. And it probably wasn't even in her character to talk about herself or her work in that way, to her great credit. So this book is that attempt to with a little distance, to consolidate her career and look at it with some perspective. So we hope you enjoy it. And with that, I wanted to turn it over to David.
Great.
Okay, I did not know Muriel Cooper either, as Rob made clear. I did, however, in I think it was January of 1995, I was a young designer working in New York, not knowing what I was doing, and I thought it would be fantastic to come and study at the Media Lab, and I arranged to make a visit up here in January of 1995 to visit the VLW. And at that point, I saw some of the work on screen. Actually, Lisa Straussfeld was a student here at the time, and was I remember thinking that it was fantastic that she had studied, that she was an architect before. But when I saw this work, then the next time I ended up not coming back to graduate school because I went to go work at IDEO in San Francisco in 1995. And I went to work for Gita Solomon, who was a student from the Media Lab and who had finished. And what was striking at the time out in San Francisco, I was hired as an interaction designer, which was a fairly quite a new field at the time. Muriel Cooper's work, and specifically the information landscapes, were presented as kind of primary material as I was starting to understand what might happen on a screen and its relationship to design. So that was soon, not so long after the TED Talk in Monterey, which we've heard described a couple times tonight from people who were there and who organized it. Anyway, when I first saw this, saw the information landscapes work, it was first as printed images in an article by Jan Abrams in ID magazine, I think. I later saw it moving, not very long after that, and I was struck as a designer with the way in which familiar typographic relationships, which conveyed meaning, which usually were done with bold or size or two-dimensional approaches, seemed to be completely intact, but just another dimension was added to it. And of course, that's a third dimension, but it's also a dimension of time, more consequentially here. And I recognized this as work that was happening on screen that opened up a whole set of possibilities, but I recognized it coming from specifically a kind of design place. It was about 10 years before I came into contact with her work again. And during that time, I was shocked that a lot of this work I didn't hear discussed within graphic design or interaction design extensively during that time period. Maybe it was my own remove from whatever scenes we're talking about it, but it was just absent. And in 2005, I came back to MIT, and I was doing some graphic design work with the Center for Advanced Visual Studies, which was at the end of its kind of run. And I stumbled into a closet up there, which was filled with posters. They were just stacked one on top of each other. Absolutely fabulous, fantastic things. Very excited to find these things. Started to pull them out. And at the same time, I found a CV from Muriel Cooper at the Center for Advanced Visual Studies from, I think, 1971. And I expected that these posters were likely designed by Muriel Cooper. I was quickly corrected, as many of them weren't. But what I recognized in these was a similar approach to what I had seen in the information landscapes, which seemed to be a kind of deep investment in the kind of temporal aspect of making a piece of graphic design work. So whether it's the rotations that are in the print on the left, which use the kind of staging of a printing press as a way to generate form, or on the right, which is made with a split fountain, which is another way of kind of using the tools to produce the graphic effect, essentially. Now, in the book, these are several spreads from the book. In the book, we've made a real attempt to show the things that we found, pieces of Muriel Cooper's work, and her students' work and ancillary materials, as much as artifacts as possible. And so you see something like the mechanical artwork for the MIT Press logo, which is presented with the masking tape on it, and the original sketch that looks like it led to this proposal for a logo on the left. These are largely left unframed by kind of writing, essentially. And the idea, as Rob described as well, was to make this a kind of source book for other people to continue this work. It seemed, given our distance from the material and the real situation, it also seemed like the most productive, positive thing we could do was present this work so that other people can take up the project, so that other people can get excited about this singular collection of design and continue it forward, whether through research or taking the ideas, et cetera. Now, you know, it gets sewn up in this giant, in this rather large book, which is very beautifully produced by the MIT Press. We're thrilled with the way that it came out. But on the spine of this book is, down in the bottom, you know, you don't have to see, is a piece of Muriel Cooper's work that we all know well, but seen in situ, not removed. And so this would have to be one of my favorite pieces of graphic design, and the way in which it oscillates between a kind of figurative typographic thing and what looks like a machine-readable graphic. But here we see it doing the work it was meant to do, which is identify this book as MIT Press. And I just think we, both of us, feel quite honored to have it published by MIT, given the subject matter that's in it. So we hope you'll look at it, enjoy it, and make some work from it. So.
Hello, everybody. I'm Todd Macover, and we have a wonderful panel here to talk about Muriel as a teacher, and I think we'll have an opportunity to talk about the culture of the visible language workshop as well. We have Ron McNeil, who was really Muriel's partner for the entire time that the visible language workshop ran, and really ran it together, so we're going to hear from Ron about how it started and what it meant and how it worked. Lisa Straussfeld, who, as was mentioned, started out as an architect but came, studied design with Muriel in Visible Language Workshop, as one of the world's most prominent designers, worked with Pentagram independently and now is at the New School University. And David Small, who, when he started working with Muriel, told me just before, I hadn't remembered this, I hadn't done any design work at all, and found his way to Muriel through photography and became a designer in Muriel's tutelage, started small design firm, which is one of the most prominent design firms in the world. So we'll talk to them in just a second. I just wanted to make a couple of comments first. One is that I was one of the very first people to be hired at the Media Lab. People like Muriel and Nicholas were at MIT before the Media Lab, but when the building opened, I was one of the first people to come here. And Muriel was one of the very kindest people to everybody, but I remember certainly to me. You know, I came here, I was 30 years old, I think. I was a musician, an artist, and Muriel understood that it wasn't so easy to be an artist in a culture, even the Media Lab, but a culture like MIT. So she never said too much about it, but she always found time to check in just to see how I was doing, to see if things were okay, and to see if that part of my creative work here was being nurtured. She really cared. Now, one of the things that I'm proudest of all the things that I do, is that I'm the Muriel Cooper Professor here at MIT. And not a day goes by when I don't think about somehow trying to live up to her example as a designer and an artist and as a mentor and as somebody who helps to shape this place and as a human being, because she really was as close to the soul of the Media Lab as anybody. And I'll just tell you one little story before I turn it over to our panelists. And Ron will recognize this, but you two won't. It has to do with her as a teacher and as a mentor. So in the early days of the Media Lab, the place was small enough that when we would go through the admissions process to pick our students, We'd actually all sit around a big table. We'd do this a few times iteratively, and all the folders for all the students would be on the table. And the place was small enough that we'd all read the folders for everybody, and we'd pass them around the table. And the idea was we'd have three or four of these meetings, and each of the meetings you were supposed to make a shorter and shorter list. You'd read the folders, and you're supposed to say, okay, there are 50 people who want to be in my group, and now my job is to figure out the 30, and now it's the 10. And every time we'd make a list on the board, and Nicholas, runs a pretty tight ship, and he would, make sure that every time we'd kind of winnow down the list. And we'd even write the names on the board of our short list, and it's an important thing to do. One of the biggest things is to pick the right students here. And I'll never forget, all of us, we wanted to follow what Nicholas wanted us to do, so we would winnow down our lists. And sure, we get to the second, third, we get to the final list, and we'd have, okay, here are the two people I really want to admit. And we'd get to Muriel, and we'd say, okay, Muriel, what's your short list? She'd say, well, I've got 20 people. And Nicholas would go, what, 20 people, no. And just, I need more time, it's 20 people. And so part of it was the Chinese menu thing about maybe not being able to decide. But I really think it's because she took so much time to think about every single one of those applicants and to figure out where there was something special, which might not be so obvious at, in the normal way of judging a student, and to figure out not only who she wanted to nurture, but what kind of group she could bring together to make the Visible Language Workshop special. It was really amazing. It drove Nicholas crazy. But she was also the only one, I think it's because you were such close friends, but also you respected each other so much, he's the only one who he would let get away with that. But she always, so here are the kind of people she admitted. So I'd like to maybe start with Ron, just to you, because you were here at the very beginning, to tell us how the Visible Language Workshop started, why it started, how it worked.
I thought that it would be nice to see the very, very grubby beginning of her third act. Where we started the VLW. So the VLW story starts in the early 1970s, way before the internet, way before the PC, with me, a photographer turned printmaker, in my workspace on the fourth floor of Building 5 of the Department of Architecture, slating over a hot offset press, teaching a class in non-silver imaging, image making called photographics. So before I met her, Muriel and I shared a friend, Tom Norton, who told her about my offset press. And as it turned out, Muriel was looking to start Act 3 of her career outside of MIT Press. So you might imagine that Muriel was visualizing something like this when Tom told her about my press. But of course, you'd be wrong, because that's what she was imagining, right? The scene of a group of eager, very smart, future designer disruptors, with Muriel as the lioness den mother, teaching them the ways of disruption. So after she came on board officially, what Muriel soon created was an iconic humanities distribution class called Messages and Means. It was consistently oversubscribed because it asked students who normally spend all day thinking abstractly to connect their imagination and their hands in creative exploration. And of course, many of them had never ever even tried to do that before. So Muriel felt strongly that the author and maker should be the same person. Or more practically, back then, that the gap between the author and the maker should be collapsed as much as possible. And in search of the closest thing to an interactive experience possible, Muriel threw out all of the then conventions of reproduction technology to get as close to a hands-on interactive design production experience as was possible, often going from concept to mask to plate to printed piece in one class. So she called this iconic class project a rotation, where the students would use square paper, create the mask by working directly on acetate with press type, but use only one plate and rotate the paper between color changes. Notice the female press operator. So sadly, very few of these pieces have actually survived, and the ones that I'm going to show you are not fabulous, but you know, they're still, I think, worth seeing. Here's the split fountain, very, very popular. The third color. Here's another approach. And yet another. So she also inherited a basic visual literacy freshman seminar called Creative Seeing. She had three assistants and a class of 60 bright-eyed, bushy-tailed students. And here they're taking part in a sky art event. So here they're mapping their physical, social, and family relationships. And then below, exploring instant reproduction technologies. And of course, they explored the book form. Just a few examples of probably an incredibly varied class. So our computational explorations started in earnest when I got a grant to build a billboard painting machine, as you see here. It worked well for about an afternoon. But the part of the project that really excited both Muriel and me was the interactive color computer graphic image and text editing system that was needed in order to create the images for the billboard painter. So after a three-year collaboration between many grad and undergrad assistants, we had one of the first artist workstations capable of synthesizing image and type in near real time. Sadly, the crude image type handling capability was a constant frustration for Muriel, but it was also extremely hard to fix because the CPU that we were using was about as fast as the first Macintosh. So there was a time sort of the middle of the project, just about every morning I would come in and see a new function or a new image added by one of the student artists that were informed by work by other students that had been done previous days. The 300 megabyte image map disk space was a big canvas that let everybody else share ideas in a free and easy way. And of course, Muriel was not off limits as a subject. So when we first moved into the Media Lab, the tools were still just as frustrating for Muriel as ever. But things began to change for the good when David Small, Suguru Ishizaki, Lisa Straussfeld, and Earl Renison began the information landscape work. Over to Dave.
Okay, David, do you want to take it from there? It's a good introduction.
Okay, thank you. So as I think has been mentioned multiple times, I was involved in that famous couple of days in Monterey at the TED 5 conference. And I was that waiter that Nicholas described, that I thought we were going to go to Monterey, we were going to speak on the second day, and then I was going to see Big Sur and go to the aquarium. It was going to be like a fantastic thing. Instead, Muriel angled from like the moment we landed to get us almost like the very last spot on the speaking schedule. And we spent those 3 days, me hunched over the computer and her changing her mind over that word. So if we can switch to the to my phone here. One thing that's always bothered me about that piece was that we really didn't have at the time any way of documenting it except to make a kind of videotape, which was always so like fuzzy and wasn't alive. And 2 years ago, when the Museum of Modern Art acquired this piece for their collection, I said, well, what do you mean acquire the piece? You want what? What is it? And they said, well, I guess the videotape. I said, well, okay, but maybe we could do more. And there's a group here at the Media Lab. There's a lot of different research groups, but there's another group called Nexus, which manages the network and all the computers. And I wrote to them. I said, do you have our backups from 23 years ago? And they were like, oh, no, they're online. I'll just email you the data. So all of the original source code was there. It's still there. I inveigled my husband to port everything to the phone over the past couple of weeks. So this is a facsimile of the presentation that was given at TED from the original source code. And this is unlike the videotape. This is really what it felt like. And so imagine, you know, this, I can see it from this angle and I can see it from this angle. But then you have Muriel over your shoulder saying, like, should it be learning and common sense? Should it be, I don't know about that color. And it was like changing over and over and over again up until like an hour or two before we went on stage. It was like one of the most terrifying of my life. And then she talked. I had no idea going into it what she was going to say. She never made a note or jotted anything down she was going to say. She just talked, and I like latched onto everything she said as much as I could and tried to keep up with her. I didn't want people to not have sort of a feel for what this actually was. So the end of the little story, hopefully not the end of the story, but the end for today was that we submitted it to the Apple App Store last night, because I was hoping I'd tell everyone you could just like go to the App Store and download it. And they kicked it out. They said it had insufficient functionality. minimal functionality. I'm like, well, yeah, it doesn't do anything. Is that all right? So it was about going down and down, tighter and tighter. And then this idea, too, of you could look at something one way, but then maybe you could look at it a different way. You can go back to this way and then this way. And to me, like, I just sat there for weeks flipping back and forth. Like, now I can read this, but the other thing is still on the screen, but now I can read that, but now I can read this. And it was just, like, one of the most exciting times of my life to have been involved in this. And I'm just happy to be able to share it with everyone here. So.
Lisa?
Thanks. I'm going to start with a little detail. So when we got those Silicon Graphics workstations at the Media Lab, which happened just after I arrived, they came with built-in fonts. And they were awful, but they also, in 3D, I think all of them had thickness. Like, you were almost sort of required to use a Z dimension. And implying that the software developers from SGI were focused on big extruded text. And one of the I think it's an important detail because the way those fonts were built by Dave and the team was really not something that was really designed into the software that landed on those workstations. And it was very much that condition that they had absolutely no thickness and the ability for them to disappear on rotation. That was really so much about what that time was about. But backing up, I'm so grateful that this event is happening, especially grateful that this book exists. Thank you to Rob, David, and MIT Press for making it happen, and to the designers. The book is so beautiful, and it will, it's such a perfect tribute to Muriel Cooper's work. I was really honored to be asked to do the foreword, and I was given, not surprised, a really impossible deadline to write the foreword for the book. I thought, there's no way we'll meet this deadline, and it did, much to my surprise. The words, the anecdotes, the experience really just kind of came out of me. And it was such a pleasure and really meaningful right now. I'm assuming no one's read the foreword yet, but In many ways, it reads as a kind of instruction manual for how to run a really successful research lab, and sort of serving my own current agenda. Part of Muriel's brilliance, I think, was in her collaborators, and I also, I mean, you know, the VLW would not have been the place it was, of course, without Ron and Dave, Suguru. I know Louis Weitzman's here. I mean, the whole group of people that she carefully curated was really extraordinary. So I encourage you to actually read the whole book. The essays are incredible. Nicholas's afterwards is incredible. And again, if you want a sense of what it was like to be in the VLW, please read it. Just a couple little anecdotes to share. And this is something that, so maybe we'll have a conversation about this at some point, but Muriel forbid technology conversations at the VLW. Literally, this is something that I write about in the foreword. You could not talk about technology in front of her. She would tell you to go to another room. It's true, right?
Yeah. Yep.
And there's something incredibly important about this and absolutely key to what she was able to do in separating these conversations that were really about experience, about design, about communication, about messages, from how it was done. She never let technology lead. I mean, we had those conversations, of course, but they did not lead. And I write about this in the foreword. I feel like I did bring this ethic, what I learned, to Pentagram, which of course now, when I joined Pentagram, I was the kind of the first digitally fluent partner to join. My team was very much, I mean, I built my practice doing the, you know, digital interactive work of my partners who were doing these, you know, still doing these amazing identity programs for corporate institutional clients. But what really became strategic, of course, as we knew, was to have that type of work be done by all the partners for their identity programs. And again, you should read the foreword, but when years ago when people came to Pentagram, when I started, they asked for a certain artifact of design, a poster, an annual report, a book, and that has completely changed. And again, it's something that, so what clients now ask for is, we've educated the clients to ask for their message to be communicated to an audience, and it's, the work has become really media agnostic. Anyway, all of these things I really took away from my experience in the VLW. I talk about, there was a, you know, a group of students with a diverse set of backgrounds from the computational side, architecture, design. The work, Muriel had really guided us. She didn't, she taught in a very unusual way. I didn't even know that I was being taught exactly, but I was really being guided. And in hindsight, I look back, and in some ways the heaviest hand was really in the choice of typefaces. and there were many weights, but there was one typeface, which was Helvetica. So this diversity of work that we produced had came together in that way. And lastly, I had to write about what I wanted to write and sort of conclude the foreword with what I felt really motivated her. I think she was, there were contradictions in that. I distinctly remember this conversation with either Ron or another designer, graphic designer, who was visiting. And they were, I was just overhearing this conversation with Muriel, and they were talking about the one word that would be kind of devastating to hear about their work. Do you remember this?
Oh, yeah.
And do you remember the word?
Oh, yeah. Nice.
Oh, okay.
No. Was it
I had a different memory of the word.
It didn't matter what the word was, as long as you cried.
Okay. The word I remember was decorative.
Oh, yes.
Similar. Well, similar. Yeah.
So, so on the one hand, Muriel, you know, wanted there to be meaning. There, she wanted to communicate. She wanted it to map to the experience of the content. She wanted to represent the content. She wanted her work to represent the content. On the other hand, another memory I have is I was on the reality engine, flying her through a financial visualization I had done. She actually gave me the Morningstar floppy disk so I could use that information. And I remember, you know, I was kind of driving the demo, and she was sitting back in the chair, and she asked me to kind of pause. She really wanted to occupy the space of numbers. She actually, despite the other comment, this contradiction is that she wanted to feel it, she wanted to be seduced by the form. And I think it was really those two things of wanting the meaning, you know, wanting the content, and wanting just the seduction and the pleasure of, you know, beautiful form. And flying, as Richard said, she wanted to fly. So, and lastly, when I tried to sum this up in the foreword, I was writing this sentence about what really motivated her. There's an M dash, I was trying to put the words together, and I concluded that what motivated her really was what was possible.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
So, thank you, and great to be here.
I think we're running a little late, so we'll just take another couple of minutes. David, I was going to ask you, you said outside, you said, boy, I'm looking back, and gee, I didn't really study with Muriel for all that long. It was only 10 years. my recollection...
It felt so much longer.
Yeah, but my recollection is you changed quite a lot over those 10 years. I just thought maybe you'd say a little bit about what you were like when you started with Muriel what happened.
Like many people, she changed my life, but I feel like, wow, she really changed the trajectory of my life. When I started, I hadn't written any software, per se, at least not at MIT as an undergraduate. I'd worked in the dark room, but that was all just with chemistry. And I didn't really know anything about design. And I had finished my undergrad, I didn't have a job, I didn't quite know what I was gonna do. And I don't recall if it was she or I, but we talked about like, well, what should I do next? And she said, well, come, you know, do work in the Visible Language Workshop. And, you know, thank God that I did. So I started out like that. Bob Sabiston taught me all he knew about software, and I taught other people, and we all taught each other. A lot of people came to the VLW not knowing how to program, and none of us started by taking a computer science course and how to program. We taught each other, and that was going to be enough. In those 10 years, like, everything changed so dramatically in the way that I had absorbed all this idea about stuff. And I never felt like she taught me, like I was being taught. Mm-hmm. I kind of complained about it sometimes. Where's the textbook? Is there ever going to be a textbook? Are you even working on the textbook? No, there was no... There was no chance there was ever going to be the textbook to come out, which, you know, a lot of people at the lab, they had a group and they slowly developed that book. That was not going to happen. But it was like this, you know, it was like this. This is the Bob Sabiston view of Visible Language Workshop. And it was like tied together with duct tape, and there's a bunch of speakers and smoke coming out of things. And at the end of it, I had learned all this stuff, and I didn't even quite realize how much she was teaching me.
Yeah. I have two more really quick questions. One's for you, Ron. I was thinking at the end of the day, these last 2 days have been our members' sponsored days at the Media Lab. At the end of the day yesterday, after, you know, it was hectic all day, our newest faculty member, Danielle Wood, who's a remarkable young woman who works at NASA and also works on community activism, was walking around looking at demos, and she came to our group. And my students were all around, and she asked, you know, she's just starting at the Media Lab, and she said, what is it that makes a group bond? What is it that makes a group feel special? And I immediately thought that of all the groups I've ever seen at the Media Lab, there was something about the feeling at the Visible Language Workshop that was just special. And I was wondering, you know, just in a few words, can you think how that worked, why that happened? Tell Danielle, because...
right. Well, as you saw, we chose superb people. And there really was no roadmap. There was a workspace, and some you know, general ideas of things that, and we all sort of dived in and got to work. I mean, I don't think it was much more complicated than that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And my last quick question for Lisa is, you told me before that you have a daughter, she's 13, you said?
She'll be 10.
Who's interested in design, interested in MIT, and just thought maybe you'd tell everyone what her name is?
Her name is Muriel.
Thanks.
I'm Muriel's nephew, Jonathan, and on behalf of Muriel's family, many of whom are here tonight, a big thank you to the press and to the Media Lab for hosting and including us in this great event. Much of the talk today has been about Muriel's role as a teacher or designer, but before she was either, she was the firstborn child of immigrant Russian and Polish parents living in Brookline. It was a typical middle-class family. Jack, her father, was a master electrician, and her mother, Jenny, stayed at home to take care of the family. Muriel, or Candy, as she was called, was her nickname, was followed by the birth of my mother, Helene, who was also known as Honey, and lastly, Charlotte, who is here tonight, who was known as Chicky. Wonderful names. Muriel had a pretty normal childhood. The only hint of what was to become a brilliant career might have been a passion for doodling and her being what at the time was called a tomboy. But today would simply be described as being fearless, strong-willed, and independent. When it was time for college, Muriel attended Ohio State with the goal of getting her BFA. But when Jack and Jenny, her parents, visited her on Parents' Day weekend, they were shocked to discover that the dorm that Muriel was staying in was filled with girls of questionable character who were smoking, leaving clothes all over the floor, and God knows what else. In their opinion, Ohio State was far too racy a place for their little girl. And so Muriel was allowed to finish the year and then was brought back to Boston, where she enrolled at the Massachusetts College of Art to pursue a career in art education. When I applied to art schools and was obsessing about which art school I should attend, Muriel calmly told me to relax. "The school isn't important," she said. "It's who you go to school with." And I can see why she felt that way. Muriel's classmates at Mass Art included a who's who of future designers and artists, including Tom Wong and Jackie Casey, both of whom could often be found sitting around the Cooper dining room table, pulling a charrette for the next morning's class. The three became lifelong friends. Jack and Jenny often worried about Muriel. Why wasn't she married? Why didn't she conform like her siblings? Why did she dress the way she dressed? They could only see that Muriel didn't fit the mold that her younger sisters did, and they didn't see her brilliance. Muriel was my aunt, but she was much more than that to me. She was my mentor, my idol, and my best friend. She was cool, she was loud, she could be brash, and she was a big part of why I became a designer. Well, to be honest, in large part, it was because of her basement. Every year it would start with a call, Muriel asking if I'd like to come by some weekend and help clean up her basement, and every year I leapt at the chance. I would spend hours upon hours in that basement with Muriel, asking her questions about where she had gotten this or that object, where she thought a particular item should go, and she would patiently show me how to plan, categorize, and organize. Looking back, I guess it was the equivalent to Mr. Miyagi's wax on, wax off method of karate training, except for a young designer. To me, that basement was a playground, a library, a time capsule, and a toy store all rolled into one. And I can remember the contents of each box and shelf like it was yesterday. Walking down the steep basement stairs, I spy a rusty erector set, barely contained by its decaying box. It was a gift from Muriel's parents to keep her occupied while she was recovering from appendicitis when she was 10 years old. And Charlotte recently told me when Muriel first asked for an erector set, her mother replied, what on earth would a girl do with an erector set? And great things, apparently. A large wok framed by bamboo steaming baskets sits in a shelf, part of a collection of kitchen gadgets, a byproduct of Muriel's adventures in Chinese cooking. My brother David lived at Muriel's house while he attended BU in the 60s, and remembers going with Muriel to Chinatown, where she would spend half of her time purchasing exotic ingredients with barely pronounceable names, and the other half chatting with the store owners. Muriel loved exploring world cuisines long before it became commonplace. And one section of the basement is filled with clothes, a few from India with fantastic colors and patterns, some from Japan, rich in their simplicity and detail, and many, many, many from Filene's basement. I think it was Elise Brink, a good friend of Muriel's, who told the story of how she joined in on one of Muriel's famous trips to Filene's. Muriel went up to the returns desk and placed a very large pile of clothes on the counter. And the woman at the counter slowly looked through the pile and shook her head and explained they couldn't accept the return. The clothes had been purchased over a year ago. It was too late to return them. And without missing a beat, Muriel calmly explained that the reason she hadn't returned them sooner was because she'd been locked away in a mental institution for the past year and that she had just been released. They nervously accepted her return. There are watches, some analog and some digital. Most are broken, which might have been a factor in her seeming inability to arrive anywhere on time. Large piles of parking tickets held together by rubber bands are a souvenir of her apparent refusal to ever pay for parking, causing the Cambridge police to show up at her office at MIT and threaten to cuff and arrest her on the spot in order to get her to pay them. And there are family photographs, magazines, and clippings. One clipping features a photograph of Muriel standing in an all-white room, and the headline states, "Designer boldly paints home interior white." And the article goes on to describe how Muriel Cooper of Brookline, in a radical move, breaking with tradition, has decided to paint the interior of her house completely white. I know, crazy. On the floor sits an unopened pack of cigarettes, and as I bend down to pick them up, I get a clear image of Muriel's habit of approaching a random smoker, a total stranger, asking if she might smell their cigarette. She would hold it in her hands delicately, like a wine connoisseur might hold the cork of a fine vintage wine, deeply inhaling from the glowing tip, a look of ecstasy spreading over her face. "I've quit smoking," she'd explain. "But God, I miss the smell." There's a box of calculators on the floor, a souvenir of a calculus class, one of many that Muriel audited at MIT. I remember how frustrated she would get doing problem sets, often cursing and swearing out loud, and how, at the time, I wondered why anyone would take a math class unless they absolutely had to. There are cameras, lots and lots of cameras, 35 millimeter, 4x4, and larger slide projectors, movie cameras, 16 millimeter, 8 millimeter, Super 8, and of course, Polaroid cameras, a medium that she loved. Right next to them is what can only be described as a shrine to all things Sony. Recorders, microphones, headphones, Walkman, Betamax cameras and players, laser discs, editing equipment. I really realize that I'm looking at the complete history of Sony Corporation up to 1994, is curated by Muriel Cooper. There are toys in a shelf, mostly robots from Japan, her latest fascination. And they trigger a memory of the elaborate Viking ship Muriel gave me when I was five or so, complete with articulated oars, that would row and sink as it slowly moved, sails billowing across the floor. It was and continues to be the best present I ever got. But most of the basement is taken up by books, and I take frequent breaks, having picked up a book to place it on a shelf only to stop, sit on the floor, and leaf through its pages. Bauhaus, Learning from Las Vegas, Violender Architecture, The Whole Earth Catalog, books by Paul Rand, Joseph Albers, Pushpin Magazine, uppercase, lowercase, comic books. Not even reading, just absorbing the pacing, the structure, the color, the visual impact that each page contained. And I was mesmerized by the cover designs, the fonts, and the images. And at the time, I didn't even realize her connection to these books that I was falling in love with. Every item in that basement was precious to Muriel. If I asked why I couldn't throw out a calculator, a Betamax player, or a gear bag, all of them long since broken or obsolete, Muriel would comment on how the interface, packaging, or design was cute. And cute was the highest form of flattery that Muriel could bestow on an object or idea. We spent many weekends together at the flea market in Squantum, coming upon a vendor selling an interesting old sign or piece of equipment or poster. Muriel would immediately start a conversation with the seller. She was not only curious about the story behind an object, but the story of the owner as well. And after 10 minutes or so of chatting, she would stop, pause, look out over her reading glasses, and remark, "Cute." And the poor vendor would look so confused. Was cute meant as a put down? Should they be offended or complimented? They didn't understand that coming from Muriel, cute was the highest of compliments. I was with Muriel when she died in Mass General Hospital in May of 1994. And I can honestly say, like many of you, not a day has gone by that I haven't thought about her. I'm not a religious man, but I've always liked the song Rock and Roll Heaven, which goes, if there's a rock and roll heaven, well, you know they've got a hell of a band. So who knows? Maybe there's a graphic design heaven. And Jackie, Tom, and Muriel are in a white, cloud-filled room, sitting around the table, laughing and drinking wine. They're solving design problems we can't possibly imagine. It's just another day of a perfect, never-ending charrette. Then suddenly, at this very moment, Muriel pauses, gets that twinkle in her eye, peers out over her reading glasses, and comments on how cute our celebration here today has been. Thank you.
Two more short speakers, and I'd like to thank you for coming. You will not see me again. And Joey Ito is our next speaker, and Amy Brand, who's the head of the MIT Press, is our last speaker. If a parent can give their child to a foster home or to somebody else and be really happy with where that child is placed, I, in some sense, gave my child to Joey Ito, who's been the director of the Media Lab for, he reminded me yesterday, it's almost 6 years. I think of it as yesterday. And when Joey joined, it was the best thing that happened to this place. So Joey, you didn't know Muriel, but you're cut from the same cloth.
Thank you, everybody, and I really appreciate everybody coming together to celebrate Muriel. And it's interesting, it's not the happiest thing, but we've recently lost Seymour and Marvin, and this feels to me like a kind of culmination of this sort of historical retrospective of the founding faculty of the Media Lab. And I think it's, for me, in addition to hearing about all of their work through students and faculty, through Nicholas, meeting all the people who were connected to them and listening to the conversations really helps me understand where a lot of this stuff comes from. And this kind of very strong creativity, disobedience, and this sort of fearlessness that sort of embodies the Media Lab. You know, I've known Nicholas for a long time, but as I start to see these other people who were involved, I'm starting to understand more and more about the DNA. And it's I think quite a testament to the founding faculty at the Media Lab that 31 years now later, you can still feel the DNA. And I think that the fact that we're still on a trajectory that was set by the original founders and set so strongly is a testament to both their vision and their character. And so today has been really wonderful in sort of understanding that. I'm peculiarly sort of overlapping with Muriel in that I'm also on the board of the MIT Press, an author there, and also the director of the Media Lab. And I think Muriel played a really important role in sort of bringing the press and the Media Lab together. And we're also continuing that. And I think there's a demonstration in the auditorium, but we've launched a journal called the Journal of Design and Science. So a lot of art, Neri has this sort of wonderful Krebs cycle that I think I got from John Maeda, who got it from Rich Gold. But this sort of four quadrants where you have sort of art and science and design and engineering. And we've done a lot of art and engineering at the Media Lab, but this sort of design and science axis hadn't been fully explored, in my view. And so we created a journal, and the idea was really that we brought a lot of hard sciences into the Media Lab. And what you realize when you meet hard scientists is that they tend to be very focused and not very aware of the context, about the sensibilities that you need when you think about things, and not really responsible necessarily for the sort of overall sensibility of the stuff that they're interacting with. And conversely, a lot of the designers we've talked to, or I've talked to, especially when you look at MIT, we have hundreds of classes that have the word design. But sort of design, a la Muriel, has sort of morphed into systems design and design of business practices and design of all kinds of things. It's become very engineer-y. And there are even sort of moves to sort of remove the aesthetic side of design. And one of the things that I've noticed as we look at complex self-adaptive systems like the climate, like the human body, that what's missing is the kind of sensibility. It's you're doing things without this approach of trying to make the thing work in a wonderful way, and that in fact the future of design is probably going back to a sensibility, an aesthetics, a kind of a vision that I think goes back to where we were starting. And so to me, designing, bringing design and science together, bringing a new science into design, bringing design into science is really important. And I think that's very much Media Lab, very much MIT Press, very much Muriel. And so that's the journal that we launched. And we're launching it also on a platform called PubPub, which was developed at the Media Lab. And it's a weird platform that allows people to make comments, allows you to version, track the versions, and it's very much a sort of living document of and creates sort of a new way of thinking about peer review, so it's much more participatory. So we'd love you to take a look and tell us what you think. I think, let's see what else I'm supposed to talk about. And I think that the main thing is that, you know, as we sort of embark on this next journey, thinking about how the work that Muriel has done and the work that Amy Brand, who you'll meet, is the new director of the MIT Press, how we can move this forward is one of the core missions of the Media Lab. So I really appreciate your past support and your future support. And with that, one last thing is that there's going to be in that room, in the Alex Dreyfus Auditorium, there will be a video of Muriel's TED5 talk from 1994. So please take a look at that during the reception. So with that, I'd like to ask Amy Brand, the director of MIT Press, to come up. Thank you.
I just think this has been a wonderful occasion. And thank you, Joey, to mark this enduring partnership between the press and the Media Lab. The way that Joey was talking about the Media Lab and this sort of quadrant or nexus of design and science and art and technology is very much the DNA of the MIT Press as well. And I think a lot of that does go back to Muriel. So just 30 seconds for me, lots of thank yous. I wish to thank all of our amazing speakers and panelists, and in particular, I really want to thank Nicholas for co-hosting this event. I know that it's really, really heartfelt for you, Nicholas, and I appreciate that given your deep friendship, and I only wish that I had known Muriel too. One person that we haven't mentioned this evening but really needs to be thanked is Roger Conover, who's sitting right over there. Roger is celebrating 40 years as the art and architecture editor at the MIT Press and has created this incredible legacy around publishing in art and architecture and design. So please talk to him. Now, you might have thought, listening to John Maeda, that you're actually going to have to buy the book. But in fact, due to a generous gift from the School of Architecture and Planning and Hashim Sarkis, everybody who was invited to this event will leave with a copy of the book. So I would like to thank, yes, all of that's up there. So thank you, Hashim. But please, if you have more people you want to buy books for, they're there for purchase as well. And Pentagram, we're just in awe of you. And in particular, again, I'd like to thank Aaron Fay and Daisy Lee, who produced those really gorgeous animations. We're definitely going to try to make use of them at the MIT Press, especially the Colophon one at the end. Many people at the press and the lab were involved in making this event possible. I can't try to list all of them, but there really are three heroes of the evening. They are Ellen Hoffman and Kate Shanigan and Kate Strauss, a really incredible and tireless event planning trio. They have impeccable taste, they have good humor, and they made being involved in planning this event a real joy and privilege for me. So thank you to all of them. And thanks to all of you for coming, and please go and enjoy the reception. Thank you.